side. Joe took his pale little bride in his arms, and she lifted her face to his. Rilla choked suddenly. It did not matter that Miranda was insignificant and commonplace and flat-featured. It did not matter that she was the daughter of Whiskers on the Moon. All that matters was that rapt, sacrificial look in her eyes, that ever-burning, sacred fire of devotion and loyalty and fine courage that she was mutely promising Joe she and thousands of other women would keep alive at home while their men held the Western Front. Rilla walked away, realizing that she must not spy on such a moment. She went down to the end of the platform where Sir Wilfrid and Dog Monday were sitting, looking at each other. Sir Wilfrid remarked condescendingly, "Why do you haunt this old shed when you might lie on the hearthrug at Ingleside and live on the fat of the land? Is it a pose, or a fixed idea?" Whereat Dog Monday, laconically, "I have a tryst to keep." When the train had gone, Rilla rejoined the little trembling Miranda. "Well, he's gone," said Miranda, "and he may never come back. But I'm his wife, and I'm going to be worthy of him. I'm going home." "Don't you think you had better come with me now?" asked Rilla doubtfully. Nobody knew yet how Mr. Pryor had taken the matter. "No. If Joe can face the Huns, I guess I can face father," said Miranda daringly. "A soldier's wife can't be a coward. Come on, Wilfie, I'll go straight home and meet the worst." There was nothing very dreadful to face, however. Perhaps Mr. Pryor had reflected that housekeepers were hard to get, and that there were many Milgrave homes open to Miranda, also that there was such a thing as a separation allowance. At all events, though he told her grumpily that she had made a nice fool of herself and would live to regret it, he said nothing worse, and Mrs. Joe put on her apron and went to work as usual, while Sir Wilfrid Laurier, who had a poor opinion of lighthouses for winter residences, went to sleep in his pet nook behind the woodbox, a thankful dog that he was done with war weddings. End of chapter 18. Chapter 19. They Shall Not Pass. One cold gray morning in February, Gertrude Oliver wakened with a shiver, slipped into Rilla's room, and crept in beside her.